हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज चैप्टर नंबर 1 फॉर क्लास 9 इन द सब्जेक्ट साइंस 1 एंड द नेम ऑफ द लेसन इज लॉज ऑफ मोशन. दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट चैप्टर. द टॉपिक्स दैट वी आर गोइंग टू कवर इन दिस चैप्टर आर मोशन ऑफ एन ऑब्जेक्ट, डिस्टेंस एंड डिस्प्लेसमेंट, स्पीड एंड वेलोसिटी, uniform and non-uniform linear motion, acceleration. We are going to study the graphs in relation to speed, velocity and acceleration. We are going to derive three equations of motion given by Newton by using graphical method, uniform circular motion. In the next part of the chapter, we are going to study force, balanced and unbalanced force. We are going to study Newton's first, second and third law of motion, momentum, law of conservation of momentum, and we will be solving numericals in between the topics. Look at the given image. Is the man at rest or in motion? Well, the man is in a state of rest. How do I know that the man is in a state of rest? It is with respect to his immediate surroundings. Now look at this image. The man may be seated in a moving car or maybe train or maybe in a van. So, by looking at this image, what do you feel? Is this man at rest or in motion? Yes, the man is in a state of motion. And how do I know this? Yes, with respect to the immediate surroundings. So we use the word rest very often. For example, when someone is not doing any work or maybe lying on the bed. We often say that the person is resting. Why do we say that? Because the person is not moving. Scientifically as well, the word rest has a similar meaning. Scientifically, we say that an object is at rest when the position of an object does not change with time with respect to the surroundings. Once again, see this image. In this case, we are saying that the man is in a state of rest with respect to his immediate surroundings. And what are his immediate surroundings? The mug, table, chair, curtain, the laptop, etc. Whereas, in the second case, we say that the man is in a state of motion with respect to his immediate surroundings. What are his immediate surroundings? The trees, the poles, the buildings, etc. So, to describe motion, we require a reference point or a frame of reference. When is a body said to be in motion? When a body changes its position with respect to its reference point, we say that the body is in motion. So in the first example, the table, mug, laptop, curtains, windows, etc. are considered to be the reference point or the frame of reference, and with respect to these reference points, the man is not changing his position. Therefore, he is considered to be in a state of rest. So, when is an object considered to be in a state of rest? When the position of an object does not change with respect to the reference point, then the object is said to be in a state of rest. In this case, the trees, buildings, electric poles, etc. are considered as the reference points, and with respect to these reference points, the man is changing his position, and therefore the man is considered to be in a state of motion. So when do we say that an object is in a state of motion? When the position of an object changes with respect to the reference point, the object is in a state of motion. Let us take more examples in order to understand the meaning of frame of reference or the reference point. As I said earlier, that In order to understand whether an object is in a state of rest or in a state of motion, we must know the reference point or the frame of reference of the object. And with respect to the frame of reference or the reference point, we can state whether an object is in a state of rest or in a state of motion. Let's take the example of an athlete running on the track with respect to the audience. Now, in this case, when the athlete is running, the frame of reference or the reference point is the audience. And with respect to the audience, the athlete changes his position. And therefore, the athlete is in a state of motion with respect to the audience, who is the frame of reference. Now, when the earth revolves around the sun, the earth is continuously changing its position with respect to the sun. So, what is the frame of reference here? The sun is the frame of reference. And with respect to the sun, the position of the earth is continuously changing, and therefore, the earth is said to be in motion. The car constantly changes its position with respect to the given path. So, the path or the road is considered as the frame of reference, and with respect to the road or the path, the car is in a state of motion. Motion is a relative concept. Let's try to understand this with the help of an example. Consider that a passenger is traveling by train. For this particular passenger, his co-passengers or fellow passengers are in a state of rest. But when this passenger looks outside the train, he finds that the buildings, trees, poles, etc. are moving in the backward direction. So, what do we understand from this example? That for one particular passenger, his co-passengers are at rest, but the objects outside the train are in a state of motion. Now, consider that this same passenger is standing on the platform, and when he looks at the passengers who are seated in the train, and when he looks at the moving train, now for the same passenger, the passengers in the train are in a state of motion. But the trees, the buildings, the electric poles, the people on the platform are in a state of rest. So what do we understand? Something which is at a state of rest with respect to one reference point is in a state of motion with respect to some other reference point. And this is what is called as a relative concept. Now, before moving on with the lesson, let us learn some of the basic concepts. Physical quantity. Now, physical quantity is any quantity which can be measured. And these physical quantities can be expressed in numbers. For example, time can be measured. We can express time in numbers, therefore time is a physical quantity. Temperature is a physical quantity because we can measure temperature, and we can express temperature with the help of number. Mass is a physical quantity. We can measure mass and express mass with the help of a number. Force is a physical quantity. We can measure force and express it in terms of numbers. So, a physical quantity is any physical property that can be expressed in numbers. Also, a physical quantity is any quantity which can be measured. Physical quantities are of two types. They are scalars and vectors. Scalar quantities or scalars. Let's try to understand scalars or scalar quantities with the help of an example. Now, when we measure time, we say that it is 5 o'clock or it is 7 o'clock. So, what is this 5, 7? These are the numbers which are associated with the physical quantity. We call them as the magnitude. A magnitude is any number which is associated with a physical quantity. So, if I am saying that it is 5 o'clock, that means the magnitude of time is 5. Now, when I measure time or when I look at my watch, do I consider the direction? Oh, when I am measuring time or when I am looking at my watch, I should be in I should be facing in the north direction, or I should be facing in the south direction, or in the west, or in the east. Do we consider direction? No. We are just interested in the magnitude or in the number which is associated with time. So, time is a scalar quantity. Let's take mass. If I say that the mass of a person is 50 kg, well, this information is sufficient for me to understand the mass of a person. Now, when the person stands on a weighing balance in order to measure his mass, and if the weighing balance shows 50 kg, what is this 50 here? It is the number which is associated, or it is the magnitude which is associated with the mass. Now, when we measure mass, do we have to look out for direction? No. So, in order to measure mass, only magnitude is sufficient. We don't need direction. So, mass is a scalar quantity. When we measure temperature of a body with the help of a thermometer, and the temperature of the body is 37.5 degrees Celsius, is this information sufficient in order to measure temperature? Yes. Because when I am measuring temperature, I am just interested in the magnitude or the number which is associated with the temperature. I am not interested in direction. I do not stand with a thermometer with my body facing towards the north or towards the south or towards the east and so on and so forth. So temperature requires just magnitude. We don't require direction. So those physical quantities which can be completely described by their magnitude alone are called as scalar quantities. It is very easy to add or subtract scalar quantities by simple arithmetic means. But there are some physical quantities which can be described not only by magnitude but also with direction. For example, force. Suppose I want to move a cupboard and I apply maybe say 2 newtons of force in order to move the cupboard. Now, just applying 2 newtons of force is not sufficient. It is also very important to understand that in which direction the cupboard has to be moved, whether I want the cupboard in the left side or on the right side or in forward direction or in the backward direction. So, along with the magnitude, that is I said 2 newtons, there is also need of direction, isn't it? So, there are some physical quantities which can be completely described by their magnitude as well as direction. Such quantities are called as vector quantities. Some of the examples of vector quantities are weight, force, displacement, etc.